This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Hawks of Hawk Hollow. Author, A Tradition of Pennsylvania. Introduction. Hear me, but don't believe me, after you have heard, says Calderon, the Spanish dramatic poet, with a droll spirit of honesty, only equaled by the English Burton, who concludes the tale of the prebend in his Anatomy of Melancholy, by exclaiming, "You have heard my tale, but alas, it is but a tale, a mere fiction, 'twas never so, never like to be, and so let it rest." We might imitate the frankness of these ancient worthies in regard to the degree of credit which should be accorded to our tradition, but it would be at an expense of greater space and tediousness than we care to bestow upon the reader. We could not declare in the same wholesale way that the following narrative is a mere fabrication, for such it is not, while to let the reader into the secret and point out the different facts, for facts there are, that are interwoven with the long gossamer web of fiction, would be a work of both time and labor. We have always held the Delaware to be the finest and noblest river in the world, not indeed that it is so, but because that was a cardinal item in our creed of childhood. And to all such points of belief we hold as strongly as we can, philosophy and experience to the contrary notwithstanding. They are holy and useful, though flimsy, ties, little pieces of rose-colored packthread that keep sorted together whole bundles of pleasant reminiscences, and therefore as precious in our esteem as shreds of gold and silver. In consequence of this persuasion, we have learned to attach importance to every little legend of adventure in any way associated with the Ganga of our affections, and of such it has been our custom, time out of mind, to construct, at least in imagination, little fairy edifices in which golden blocks of truth were united with the cement of fancy. A novel is, at best, a piece of mosaic work of which the materials have been scraped up here and there, sometimes in an unchronicled corner of the world itself, sometimes from the forgotten tablets of a predecessor, sometimes from the decaying pillars of history, sometimes from the little mine of precious stones that is found in the human brain, at least as often as the pearl in the toad's head, of which John Bunyan discourses so poetically in the apology for his Pilgrim's Progress. Of some of the pebbles that we have picked up along the banks of the Delaware, the following story has been constructed, but at what precise place they were gathered, we do not think it needful to say. The torrent of fashionable summer rustication has already sent off a few little rills of visitation towards different corners of Pennsylvania, and one has begun to flow up the channel of the Delaware. In a few years, eheu fugaces, posthume, this one will increase to a flood, all of men, women, and children, rolling on towards the water gap, and then some curious individual will discover the nook into which we have been prying, and perhaps, if he chooses, come off with prizes still more valuable. At all events he will discover, and that we hold to be something worth recording, that his eyes have seldom looked upon a more enchanting series of landscapes than stretches along this river, in one long and varied line of beauty, from New Hope and the Nockamixon Rocks almost to its sources. The story, such as it is rather a domestic tale, treating of incidents and characters common to the whole world, than one of which these components can be considered peculiarly American. This is, perhaps, unfortunate, the tendency of the public taste seeming to require of American authors that they should confine themselves to what is, in subject, event, and character, indigenous to their own hemisphere, although such a requisition would end in reducing their materials to such a stock as might be carried about in a nutshell. America is a part of the great world, and like other parts, has little that is suited to the purposes of fiction which it can call exclusively its own. And how far that little has been already used up anyone may tell who is conversant with our domestic literature. Some little, however, of that little yet remains, and by, we will perhaps ourselves join in the general scramble after it. To conclude our prolegomena, we recommend to all Philadelphians who thirst for the breath of the mountains, and are willing to breathe it within the limits of their own noble state, to repair to the Delaware water gap, sit them down in the porch of our friend Snyder, or Schneider, we forget, whether he yet sticks to the Vaterlandish orthography or not, discourse with him concerning trout, deer, and rattlesnakes, and make themselves at home with him for a week. They will find themselves in one of the boldest mountain passes in the United States, in the heart of a scene, comprising crags, forests, and a river sprinkled with numerous islands, all striking, harmonious, and romantic. There, indeed, is neither a round top nor a Mount Washington, with ladders on which to climb to heaven. But there are certain mountain ridges hard by, from whose tops he who is hardy enough to mount them can well believe he looks down on heaven, so broad, so fair, so Elysian are the prospects that stretch below. There also our friends will find such lime trees, as will cause them to rejoice that they have planted scions of the same noble and fragrant race at their own doors, and such a glorious display of rose bays or rhododendrons, the noblest of American flowering shrubs, as may perhaps teach them the wisdom of transferring a few to their own gardens. But we have not space to mention one half the charms that await them in the gap. If they have eyes to distinguish between the flutter of wings and loose hanging mosses, they may behold, at evening, the national bald eagle, soaring among his native cliffs, and winging to his perch on the far-up old hemlock, where they may see his reverend white head gleaming like a snowflake among the leaves, until the wail of the whippoorwill calls the shadows of night over the whole mountain. Besides all this, and the other charms too tedious to mention, if they commend themselves to the favor of mine host, they will be roused up in the morning by the roar of a waterfall under their very pillows, and then, leaping into a boat, and rowing into the river, they may survey it at their ease, as lovely a sheet of foam rushing over a cliff 140 feet high, as was ever stolen from its bed of beauty to drive, eheu, eheu conditionem hujus temporis, the machinery of a sawmill. Volume 2. Chapter 1. It has been seen how the rejoicings at the promontory were interrupted in their very beginning by the sudden discovery of the refugee. So, dread for his daring doe and bloody deed, that his mere name had thrown all present into confusion. The crowning climax was put to the general panic when some of the late pursuers were seen returning early in the afternoon, whipping and spurring with all the zeal of fear, and scattering such intelligence along the way as put to flight the last resolution of the jubilants. The news immediately spread that Oran Gilbert had burst into existence, not alone, but with a countless host of armed men at his heels, that he had attacked and routed the pursuers, hanging all whom he took alive, especially the soldiers, and that he was now, in the frenzy of triumph, marching against the devoted Hillborough, with the resolution of burning it to the ground. Such dreadful intelligence was enough to complete the terror of the revelers. They fled amain, and long before night, the flag waved, and the little piece of ordnance frowned in utter solitude on the top of the deserted headland. It is true that there came by and by couriers with happier news, but too late to arrest the fugitives. And as these riders made their way towards the village, expressing some anxiety lest it should be attacked, they rather confirmed than dispelled the fears of the few inhabitants of the valley. From one of the coolest and boldest, Captain Loring, who fastened on him at the park gate, learned that there had been no action indeed, and that the fugitive had made his escape. But on the other hand, it appeared that there were refugees in the land, that they had hanged a soldier named Parker, and made good their retreat from the place of execution, that the greatest doubt existed among the pursuers in relation to the route they had taken and the objects they had in view, some believing on the evidence of a certain Quaker who had been their prisoner, that they were marching by secret paths against the village, while others insisted that this was a feint designed only to throw the hunters off the scent, and to secure their escape, that in consequence the party had divided, pursuing the search in all directions in the hope of discovering their route, and finally, that it was now certain the band, whose number was supposed to be very considerable, was really commanded by the notorious Oran Gilbert. From this man also, Captain Loring learned a few vague particulars in relation to the two greatest objects of his interest, namely Henry Falconer and the young painter, who had fallen into a quarrel in consequence of some misunderstanding about their horses, the officer having used harsh language not only in regard to the unceremonious seizure by Herman of his own steed, but in reference to a similar liberty the refugee had previously taken with the painters, which, Falconer averred, was an evidence of intimacy and intercourse betwixt Mr. Hunter and the outlaw. It behooved the former to explain, before thrusting himself into the company of honest men and gentlemen. This quarrel, it seemed, had been allayed by the interference of Falconer's brother officers, and the informant had heard something said of a proposal to drown the feud in a bowl. As for the man of peace, Ephraim, it appeared that his spirited assistance during the chase, and especially his success in exposing the secret haunt of the Tories in the Terrapin Hole, the scene of Parker's execution, had not only removed all suspicion in relation to his character, but had highly recommended him to the favor of his late captors. With such news, the captain strode back to his mansion, and awaited, with his daughter and kinswoman, the return of the officers to the Hollow, and their appearance at the hall, which he doubted not they would instantly make after returning. He waited, however, for a long time in vain, and by falling sound asleep, as he watched the sun creeping beneath the western hills, escaped the intelligence which was soon after brought to the house, that the officers had returned to the Hollow, and instead of reporting themselves forthwith under his hospitable roof, had made their way to the widow's inn, where they were carousing with a zeal commensurate with the spirit they had exhibited during the troubles of the day. This unexpected termination of a day of heroism, a termination that surprised and irritated Miss Falconer as much as it perhaps secretly pleased the captain's daughter, was a consequence of the late quarrel, or rather a mode of burying it in oblivion, devised by Captain Caliver, who had contracted an esteem for the painter, and preferred his ease in his inn to all the delights and blandishments that might be expected in the society of Gilbert's Folly. As the superior officer, he had taken the command into his own hands, and besides arranging his forces so as to watch all the approaches to the valley, and dispatching Lieutenant Brooks to the village to communicate with the authorities there, he declared his resolution to erect his headquarters in the Hollow, at a place like the Traveler's Rest, where, while still commanding the road, he would be near enough to protect the females and non-combatants in the captain's house. And besides, he added facetiously, while riding up to the little inn, as we men of the sword are protectors of widows as well as orphans, we will thus protect a forlorn old woman from mischief, and put a penny into her pocket, and drink our wine at our ease. For you remember, Falconer, my young brother, you swore by all the gods you would have some of the wherewithal smuggled up to this identical old woman's whiskey house. I swore it, by the eternal Jupiter, said Falconer with a grin. And by the eternal Jupiter, I am as ready for a blow up now as another time, only that we must blow fast, so as to run up to Hal to be scolded before bedtime as soon as Brooks comes. And as for Mr. Hunter here, why he and I can blow out one another's brains in the morning. If thee talks in this evil-minded, bloodthirsty manner, said Ephraim Patch indignantly, I give thee warning, I will have nothing to do with thy wholesome wines and thy goodly brandies, whereof thee hast spoken, and whereof much good may be said in regard of them that are faint and weary. If thee will eat, drink, and be merry, all in a civil Christian way, without drawing any weapons more dreadful than corks, pulling only at the bottle instead of the pistol, and neither swearing profanely, nor drinking foolish irreligious healths, thee shall have me in company to give thee good counsel, whereof thee has considerable much need, as well as thy long-nosed friend here, not meaning any offense, which thee calls captain, and the youth also friend Hunter. Verily, I am both hungry and thirsty, and will sooner enjoy the creature comforts in this quiet hovel, than even the satisfaction of bringing the breaker of laws into the hands of justice. Verily, the thought of these goodly wines doth make my mouth water, and I shall rejoice, even to the bottom of my spirit, if they have already reached the house of the widow. We do not design to relate the joys of the banquet shared by the four worthies, and some two or three young men of the county, who had shown themselves men of spirit, and remained bravely by the side of the officers, resolved, as they said, to contribute their aid to the defense of the Hollow. It is only worthy of remark, first, that the ill blood between young Falconer and the painter gradually wore away, and was succeeded, on the part of the former, by a sudden friendship which bade fair to ripen into fondness, and on that of Highland, by what was at least a show of reciprocity. Secondly, that honest Ephraim gradually displayed as much spirit in the feast as he had before manifested in the fray, and became to the surprise of all the soul of mirth and drollery, so that young Falconer, clapping him on the back, swore with the favorite oath of his friend Caliver he had never seen a jollier old broadbrim. And thirdly, that this capricious young gentleman grew so enamored of his company that he ceased to talk, as he did at first, of the necessity he was under of paying his sister and friends a visit at the Folly, until he was roused to recollection by the sudden retreat of his new friend from the cottage. The painter was detected in the very act of stealing, or as they chose to call it, sneaking from the apartment, and Mr. Falconer, uttering a loud, "Hillo, halt, deserter," volunteered to bring him back to the punishment immediately ordered by the captain of cavalry of a glass of salt and water. He rushed from the room, and plainly beheld the youth in the light that flashed from the window, spring from the porch, and dive into the midnight shadows of the oak trees, for it was now completely dark. As he retreated, he stumbled over some obstruction in the path, but instantly recovering himself, he leaped over the little brook, and was soon out of sight. "Hillo, Hunter, my boy," cried the lieutenant. "Why, zounds, there he goes up the road like a light horseman. Why, gad, here the fool has dropped his handkerchief. No, gad's my life, 'tis a paper. Hillo, painter, you've dropped something. A letter, as I'm alive, ehem, hiccup, a very handsome constellation that Great Bear, never saw the pointer shine so brightly in my life. Gad's my life, and adzooks, as Captain Loring says, 'tis the lights in the Folly after all, and here am I carousing like an ass, instead of playing off the Romeo to Catherine by starlight. Now Hal will scold like 20 housekeepers, Catherine will look sulky, and as for the captain, why, I suppose he will fall into one of his patriarchal rages. Gad, but I feel rather warmish and particular, but this cool night air is a good thing for settling one's nerves. I warrant me, that rascal Hunter has gone up there before me. A very handsome, well-behaved dog, and I like him immensely." With such expressions as these, the young man, whose brain, never one of the strongest, was at present whirling in confusion, began to make his way towards the Folly, without troubling himself to think what amazement or affliction his absence might cause his friends. Indeed, he was fast verging towards that happy state in which man shows his loftiest contempt of the world and the world's ways, and his disregard of all those restraints and encumbrances which society has imposed upon the freeborn lord of creation. He had left the hovel without his hat, but what cared he for such a superfluity of a fine summer night, even although beginning a walk over hill and hollow of full a mile in extent? Had he left it even without his boots, it is questionable whether he would have noticed the deficiency until recalled to his senses by the roughness of the road. In a word, the wine he had already swallowed had made serious inroads upon a brain that was always very poor and unhappy for drinking. And as it frequently happens in such cases, the exercise of walking more than counteracted the effects of the cooling air. So that by the time he had trudged half the distance towards the paddock, the young gentleman was in the happiest spirits imaginable, wholly insensible of his condition, and almost unconscious of the purpose that had drawn him so far. He even began to sing along the road, and by the time he had reached the gate was trolling a song of a character ludicrous enough to come from his lips, but which, perhaps caught originally from those of some wag or philosopher of the camp, was now suggested by the spirit of happy indifference it breathed to all sublunary concerns, and was therefore in excellent harmony with his own feelings. It was the song of Poor Joe, and was sung with wondrous emphasis and gusto. Apparently he found the madrigal just one stanza too short, at least for his present mood, for which reason so soon as he had finished the last of all, he began to repeat it, with even more expression than before, and had just reached the second line. "My elbows peep out to the storm," when one of his own elbows was suddenly seized upon, and a voice bitterly reproachful muttered in his ear, "Are you mad? Are you mad, brother? Are you mad? What? How? Sister, is that you? Gad's my life, I knew you would scold me, but if you would only consider. But now I think of it, egad, what brings you out here of a dark night singing Poor Joe like an old soldier? Adzooks, as the captain says, I am quite astonished. Brother, you are, oh, that you should be so insensible to interest, if not to shame, cried Miss Falconer with deep feeling. Brother, brother, you. If I have, may I be shot, cried the young officer hastily, as if the instinct of long habit had taught him what his sister intended to say. That is Harry, my dear, nothing to speak of, and it is all on account of Caliver, who betwixt you and me is so deuced soft-headed. He is, egad, one must always sit by to take care of him. As for me, Hal, why, I can drink a hogshead of any such wishwashy stuff as these French wines. I can, by the eternal Jupiter, as Caliver says, and at the present moment I am. Ruined, irretrievably ruined, cried his sister, and by your own folly, by your own miserable, infatuated dissipation. You have lost Catherine Loring. Lost Catherine Loring? My Catherine Loring? Cried the young man in alarm. Have the hawks carried her off? What if I say yes? Replied Harriet, and then added, with a tone that brought the youth still farther to his senses, and I must add, that even a base and renegade Gilbert is worthier of her than you, my brother, the son of Richard Falconer. Oh, shame upon you, brother, shame upon you! Harry, you are joking with me, cried Falconer, with a voice somewhat quavering and querulous. We've driven the dogs the Lord knows whither, and as for that story of the village, why, that's all a fib. So as to carrying Catherine off, I don't believe a word of it. And yet you have lost her, perhaps, beyond all redemption. Oh, Harry, brother Harry, were you but enough in your senses to understand me? I am, sister, I am, cried Falconer, and indeed the devil drunkenness was fast giving place to the devil fear. I have been drinking, but I swear to heaven. Swear no more, you have done so a dozen times already. I have done so, sister, but I swear again, and I call heaven to witness, that if you have spoken the truth, and Catherine be really lost, I will never drink more till I have recovered or revenged her. But for pity's sake, speak, what is the matter? I am sober now. What has brought you out here in the dark? Where is Catherine? What is the matter? You shall hear, cried Miss Falconer hurriedly, perhaps it is not yet too late. You have a rival, brother, a dangerous rival. Oh, gad now, sister, Lord, is that all? Exclaimed the young man, bursting into a laugh. Why, you don't think I shall go jealous because I have a rival? Gad, Harry, you're the most absurd sister in the world. I wonder what the deuce has become of my hat. A rival, Hal? One of these village clotpoles. A dozen of 'em, if you like. The more the merrier. I'll invite 'em all to my wedding. You are mad, cried Harriet. Wedding indeed. Perhaps you will never be married. What think you of a rival that has her heart? Her heart? Catherine's heart, exclaimed the gay-brained soldier. Why, it has been mine these 2 years. And now, said Harriet, it is another's, brother, rouse from your dream of confidence and security. It is as true as that the stars are above us, Catherine Loring loves another. Harriet! It is true, she confessed it with her own lips. Confessed it, sister, said the young man, and then added, with a spirit that surprised her, if that be so, why then good luck to her, she shall have her freedom. I don't think I shall break my heart, and certainly I shan't force her to marry me. But Hal, look you, sister Hal, I did not think she would cousin me. She confessed it, did she? Why, that's enough. I'm an honorable man, but after being cheated and jilted I don't care much, but if I don't kill the scoundrel, Hal, I say if I don't kill him, you may have leave to call me a fool and chicken twice over, confess it. If this display of spirit surprised Miss Falconer, the manifest distress with which her brother spoke, incredible as it may seem, greatly gratified her. His greatest fault in her eyes, that is, aside from his dissipated habits, was that easy indifference of disposition, or indolence of feeling, which kept him reckless and passive when she would have had him ardent and energetic. She knew him to be insensible of the full value of that prize. It was her ambition to secure him, and had he been any but her brother, she would have hated him for what seemed the feebleness of his affection, as indicated by the little pains he took to secure that of Catherine. It was obvious, from this homely burst, in which magnanimity, pride, indignation, anger, and distress were all so characteristically jumbled together that the young gentleman had really feeling enough at bottom, and that, in a great measure, of the right kind, and the discovery brought a ray of hope into her mind. "Brother," said she, "if you really love Catherine, you may yet save her." "What, after confessing she loves another?" cried he sulkily. "Now, Hal, for all your wisdom, you don't know me. I won't have her." "Confess, indeed?" "No, she did not confess, I will explain. Perhaps 'twas only a dream, it was in her sleep." "In her sleep?" cried Falconer, and then burst again into a roar of laughter. "In her sleep?" he ejaculated, giving way to a second peal. "Well, you have scared me with a vengeance, but I forgive you, you have brought me to. Of all the cunning doctors in the world, give me yourself, Harry, you are infallible." "And so she confessed in her sleep, poor soul, did she?" "Oh, Hal! Hal! Hal!" And here the capricious youth gave full swing to his merriment. "Thus it is," said his sister impatiently, "one extreme or the other, ever. Listen, brother, for I am serious. Your wild habits have greatly weakened Catherine's affections. Another comes in the meanwhile, with attractions, I will not say superior to your own, but perhaps every way equal, who ceases not neither by day nor by night, to influence her imagination and engage her heart. Judge of his success, when you know that she has admitted him to intimacy, nay, to confidence. Judge, when I tell you that she trembles at the sound of his voice, turns pale at the echo of his footsteps, blushes when he speaks, looks glad when he is by her, and weeps when he is absent. And finally, who hides the secret from her own waking thoughts, yet babbles his name over in her dreams and sheds tears and smiles with her tears when she murmurs it. Is not such a man, the object of such emotions, himself so passionately enamored, that his visage betrays the thought of his bosom, even when he knows he is suspected and watched? Is not such a man a dangerous rival?" "Sister, you know better than myself," said Falconer uneasily, "if you think so." "I do, brother. I believe that this moment, without knowing it herself, Catherine's mind is dwelling upon your rival, and if he be not driven away, you will lose her. Point him out to me, Sister Harriet, and then by—" "No fighting, no fighting, brother," cried Harriet in some alarm and speaking with eagerness. "Not a hair of the young man's head must be harmed. We have done him injury enough among us, perhaps, already. We must frighten him away. If I know him, we can legally expel him from the valley. Arrest, imprison him, banish him, do anything, but harm him not, that is, do him no harm with your own hands. If he have forfeited his life to the law, let the law take it. Now, brother, know your rival. It is the youngest brother of this dreadful Oran Gilbert." "Saints and devils," cried Falconer with vivacity, "a hawk of the hollow, and dare to love Catherine Loring?" "I could be sworn to it," said Harriet. "The circumstances that pointed out the assassin of my father were but clues of thistle, down to the chains of evidence that led me to the knowledge of this skulking raven's character. The first circumstance was as strong as the last. An idle, thoughtless, nay, an accidental pencil mark on a drawing opened my eyes in an instant, and heaven's light immediately streamed through them. But think him not the coarse cutthroat his name would indicate. He has had a gentleman's breeding, and such is his bearing. I doubt not that he is a confederate of his brother, perhaps even a spy, and I am persuaded it was he who counteracted our scheme of seizing the reprobates, and brought the poor soldier Parker to the gibbet. He must be arrested and examined. He knows he is suspected. He knows that I suspect him, but will, in his audacity, remain in the assurance that no real proof can be brought against him. That man, that painter, brother, that hunter, where did you leave him?"
"Leave him?"
cried Falconer. "Why is he not here? Sure, he led the way hither, and sure I followed after him. A rare fellow, sister. I was going to blow his brains out, but egad, I know him better, and gad, I am coming on fast to adore him. Adzooks, as the captain says, I picked up his letter and—"
"His letter?"
cried Harriet eagerly. "Where is it?"
"Here," said the lieutenant, drawing it from his pocket, wherein he had safely bestowed it.
"To the light,
cried the maiden, snatching it out of his hands, and running with the speed of a frightened deer toward the mansion, followed by her bewildered brother. A candle blazed in one of the windows that opened on the porch, and in the chamber it lighted. Had she been disposed of?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.